Broadcasting live from the Business Radio X studios in Phoenix, Arizona, it's time for Phoenix Business Radio, spotlighting the city's best businesses and the people who lead them.
Good afternoon and welcome to Collaborative Connections Radio Show and Podcast, sponsored by KLM Consulting. I'm your host, Kelly Lorenzen, and we are zooming in to the Phoenix Business Radio X studios inside Max 6. Collaborative Connections is a radio series created to bring entrepreneurs, nonprofits, and associations together to build relationships, foster collaboration, and grow a stronger community together. Our hope for today is that listeners and guests alike will walk away with a golden nugget or a new resource for their business. And today I have the honor of being in the studio with three amazing people that I'd love to introduce you to. I'll start with Sukki from the Tempe Chamber. Welcome. Thank you for being here.
Thanks, Kelly. Thanks
Tell
for having
us a
me.
Little bit about you and the chamber. I mean, I know everything, no. but I'd love to have our listeners and guests who don't know about the chamber, can you tell us a little bit about your background and what you got going on at the chamber?
Sure. So I'm originally from Ohio, moved here to Phoenix about 7 years ago. I've been with the chamber for the last almost 4 years. My background is marketing and events, 20 years now I have. 2018, I got my CMP, which is a Certified Meeting Professional International designation, really proud of that. And so my role here at the Chamber is to oversee, so I'm the VP of Marketing and Programs. So I oversee the communications, our events, our communications website, everything marketing, and I just really love it here. And I know, Rochelle and Kelly and Karen because of the chamber. So, and that's what's going on here. We're an advocacy and legislation advocate for businesses. You know, we do have great events and networking and all of that, but our mission is really driven by helping businesses through legislation and advocacy, making sure they have a voice locally and statewide and federally.
And you guys do such a good job of that. And you know, even if we don't, I always pay my dues no matter what, because I figure it's going towards something good, right? And of course, I get way more out of it than that. And we'll hear all about all the programs, but you guys do such a good job at advocating for businesses. So we really appreciate that.
Well, thank you. We are proud of the work that we do. So I appreciate that.
And Rochelle Poulton, welcome again to the show. Thanks for being on today.
Thanks for having me. It's always a blast.
Give us a little bit of your background and where you come from and what you're up to now.
Awesome. Well, my name is Rochelle Poulton. I am currently a realtor with Realty Executives, and I have about 20 years of real estate experience. I started out working at a brokerage. I was in mortgage lending for a while, and I also am of counsel at Poulton and Royan, where I practice in real estate law and business litigation. So I used to own a law firm called Arizona Credit Law Group, and we're currently selling it. So it was a fun ride. I love doing consumer advocacy, but I really enjoy real estate. So I've recently transitioned to doing it full time with a company me and my husband Mike formed called AZ Own It. So you can find us online at azownit.com.
That's exciting. And with all your background, it's so cool because you have the legal side of it, which, you know, those of us I was in real estate, we had to learn that, right? Learn it and then go do the real estate part. So it's nice you have that background. And working on the mortgage side and all of it. So great well-roundedness. Thanks for being on. Dillon, welcome to the show. Tell the listeners where you come from and where you're headed.
All right. Thanks for having me. My name is Dillon Winiecki. I'm the owner of Protect Property Inspections. It's a home inspection company based out of Peoria, Arizona, but you know, we go all over, so don't think that we just stay in Peoria. I was born and raised in Flagstaff, and so I moved down here about 6 years ago, was hired with Phoenix Fire as a firefighter, and always had a dream of having a business on the side, and it kind of turned into my full-time career over here doing home inspection. So You know, we've only been in business for 3 years, which doesn't seem like long, but, you know, our experience and, you know, just the service we provide has shined through, and the fact that we've basically doubled the amount of inspections we do every month since we started. I mean, we're just growing and growing, and I've actually had to hire 6 other inspectors. So it's been pretty interesting ride hiring people and, you know, teaching people and training and trying to just provide a great service and hope that everybody can provide the same service I expect, right? So just something new and exciting, and, you know, pleased to meet you guys. Thanks for having me on today.
It's exciting. And he says full time, every fireman we know, my husband's a fireman, every fireman we know has a side gig, right? And then eventually they're so good at it usually that it takes over, and they'll be, oh man, how am I going to give my shifts away, or how am I going to get my shifts covered, right?
Right.
Even though that ends up being your passion project, right? The firefighting ends up being a passion project probably for most. But it's so exciting to hear in new business and growing businesses, especially in the times we're in right now. I love highlighting people that are, you know, creating new things and building their businesses, because we all need to hear that, right? We all need to know that it's okay that business is still going and growing. So I'm excited for all of you. And on that note, Sukki, I'd love to hear from your perspective and the Chamber's perspective, how business has been over the last year and what you think the horizon looks like, at least from the Chamber's perspective and, you know, advocacy.
Well, you know, this has been quite a journey over the last almost year now, going from, you know, riding the ride, having a good old Chamber time, and then, you know, having the pandemic hit the business community. It's been a roller coaster. We've seen some businesses, you know, that had to shutter up right away. We saw other businesses that were able to maintain. We saw other businesses that were able to grow and or, you know, swerve. I don't like to say pivot. They were able to swerve their business model into something that works, you know, for what's going on right now. So, you know, we're very lucky to have great membership. We haven't seen much decrease in our renewals or anything of that nature. We've got a lot of new folks joining, because I think what the pandemic did was shine a light on what we do as a chamber. I mean, even members that have been with us for many years have said, you know, now I realize how hard at work you are for the business community, because they saw us, you know, helping get information out through webinars. They saw us working on, you know, ways to get grants and loans and funding for their businesses. My CEO, Anna, is always looking at bills and legislation, making sure that the wording is protecting businesses as best as we can. So it's been really exciting to see the visibility that our members now have on our mission and what we really do for the business community.
I love that. And tell us numbers wise, where are you at with membership?
So we have over 600 members. We're steady and strong on that number. Like I said, we have a lot of new members joining, and although we may have lost a few that have had to close, we're staying strong on renewals, and those new members are joining willingly and happily because they see the work that we're doing and they want to support our mission.
And you, I love your swerve word. I'm going to use that.
I stole it from Michelle Obama's.
I love that. I love everything she says. Moving, you know, to the online platforms for networking and all your events, you guys did such a good job at that. And I think that's a testament. Seeing the increase in membership, I think, is a testament to say, hey, just because we can't get together in person doesn't mean we can't do this online. And I bet you're having more, a wider spread, right, of membership, not just locally or hyper locally in Tempe. Are you seeing other businesses further out because we can do everything online now?
Yes, that's absolutely true, because, you know, where we had events and networking, you know, opportunities before, folks would have to drive to a venue, you know, sit through the event or the networking, which is great. But it took a large chunk out of their day. And, you know, maybe regionally it didn't work for them to come into town that time. But we've been able to increase our viewership of all of our signature events. and our ribbon cuttings and mixers, because it's so easy to just log on, check it out, be a part of things, and get right back to work. With our signature events, we are offering more virtual seats than we were with just a table of 10. So our sponsors now have the ability to have a wider viewing audience. Maybe they've got folks regionally that have never been to one of our events before. Now they can tune in. So for example, we just finished our 4-week speaker series. And our first week, we had over 200 people tuned in. And in years past, our top total at an in-person event was 80 to 90 people. So wow. It's really amazing to be able to see the numbers that have increased as far as visibility to our programming and content.
I love that. The silver lining, that's been my words, my phrase for the last year, finding the silver lining and how cool that is. And I think that's true for all of our businesses is now that this is so easy to do online Dillon, I know you talked about you and I talked about your inspections and having stuff, to do online. So tell us a little bit about how you shifted or pivoted or moved. And I bet that's helped quite a bit for the online stuff.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, one of the biggest things was kind of when COVID first started, people were a little bit weird about people coming into their homes and touching everything, right? And that's what home inspectors do. So just making people feel comfortable being professional, wearing your mask, wearing booties, I know your question is about, more technology, but I think it's worth touching on that. That was a reality in the beginning, was people were a little bit worried, and some still are even. I mean, it kind of just depends on your beliefs or how you've been affected or your family members but either way, we try to swerve or adapt to basically anything a client needed or wanted. We were willing to provide that or make it happen if we could. If it was out of question, okay, but usually we could figure out a way to make it work. So, we started doing a lot of virtual reviews. So something that's really important to us is we do the home inspection, which usually never takes less than 3 hours. I never schedule less than 3 hours for my inspectors. So we like to be thorough. We like to take our time. We only do one a day, so that we're not in a rush, right? And then the most important part of that is we invite the client as well as their real estate agent to come to the end and walk through with us. And I literally mean walk through. We like to walk them around the property and physically point to things we find and explain them and educate on them. Not just bad things, but good things too, or just things to educate the homeowner. Hey, this is what this means. This is what this does and how it works. And so, well, how are we going to do that if people want to stay home? So we started using FaceTime and Google Duo and Zoom and basically whatever platform somebody was familiar with using, we learned how to use it so that we can provide that to them. And it actually worked really good. And then, it kind of helped because, and Rochelle will be able to attest to this, that so many people are coming from out of state that now that became a reality that we were kind of already ready to go. Oh, hey, by the way, we can do your home inspection virtually and you don't have to even show up to it because you live in New York. So don't worry. We'll show you how thorough we are. We'll show you that you hired a good person and that you can trust us and that your real estate agent, that they're referring us because we're good. And here's why. And then we Zoom or we virtually go in and show them. And so that was huge. And that's been really big for me. And then at times when we did slow down, which is kind of rare, but it slowed down a little bit over the holidays. Pretty normal for real estate, I think, just with people not wanting to move around much and just kind of want to stay in and be with their family, which is important. And so I took some time to reach out to some new realtors and, where usually I would say, hey, do you want to go out for coffee or breakfast or something like that? Most realtors are so busy, they don't have time to do that, but they did have time to do a quick 15-minute Zoom meeting, and I could at least tell them what we have to offer and why I believe that we, have a really good home inspection service to offer. And we have some different things that we do that maybe your previous home inspection companies didn't do. So kind of getting our name out there and our way of doing things out there. And so I'm thankful for the Zoom. I'm thankful for all the technology and the ways of, getting us out there and providing our service. So
I love that. And I know Rochelle is she's a tech guru. She showed me a lot of stuff on StreamYard and a bunch of different things. So tell us how you're seeing the shift, Rochelle, in real estate and law.
Yeah, so, you know, obviously Arizona is a super hot market. Like, there are a lot of hot spots in the country right now for real estate, but the Arizona metro market is super hot. It is totally a seller's market. And we still get people coming in day after day after day by the hundreds. I think we had like 80 something thousand new residents last year, but only 25,000 like building permits. Nice. So housing's fun. So if your rent's high, that's why. And if you're looking at buying, it's always a good time to buy. It's always a good time to sell. And Arizona is just sort of expanding the Phoenix metro area to include places like Casa Grande. So with Starlink coming out and, you know, people being worried about internet and hotspots, probably won't be a concern. This time next year, I assume with the developments in technology, you could literally live in the middle of the forest and still have a great Wi-Fi connection. So, it's just interesting to see more people work remotely full time. And a lot of businesses are starting to consolidate their office space to accommodate more people working from home. And it doesn't look like a lot of people will be given the choice moving forward of whether or not to work in an office setting or work from home. So I don't see that going anywhere anytime soon. I think we're still in this for a year or two. And then, of course, there's certain businesses that just make sense to work from home. So looking at, you know, people who want an extra bedroom, an extra space so they can have an actual office where they can isolate themselves from the kiddos and the pets for a couple of hours a day, definitely an option, especially right now. So on the technology front, obviously virtual tours, 3D tours are great. Photographers are making a killing right now with, you know, having to take thousands of photos of houses these days. So people don't feel the need to like do a lot of walkthroughs, and there's still open houses. There's still plenty of opportunities to view a house. But one thing that's really awesome in real estate is that you can actually schedule your home tour now. Like, you want to go see a house, you can pick a time and a date instead of, you know, just sort of winging it the way it was in the past. So that's pretty awesome. You can kind of work with the homeowner's schedule and with the buyer's schedule. So that's a pretty awesome, like, welcome to 1990 with like online scheduling, but we finally got there. So it's really good. And then on the legal side, you know, one of the big perks is virtual hearings. I mean, you can actually like go to court now and attend your hearing via Zoom. I mean, I think we all saw the cat guy on the internet where the attorney showed up for a court hearing, but he had a cat filter on his Zoom. And so one of the funniest things he said was like, I'm ready to proceed. Obviously I'm not a cat.
Oh man.
I mean, they fixed it, but I mean, it's, you know, like everyone is kind of, even professionals, like even your CPA will have a meeting with you via Zoom. Like, we've sort of embraced this video conferencing as a professional method of communication. So I really enjoy that. I really love education. So it's great to be able to take CEs and CLEs virtually all the time instead of driving an hour here for a 30-minute thing. So I'm a big fan of 15-minute Zoom calls. I'm a bigger fan of, you know, happy hours via Zoom. So I also like to go to brunch every now and again, obviously wearing masks outdoors, spread out from the people. But
was that an invite or was that...
Is that an invite? He wants to know if you're inviting him to brunch, Rochelle.
Sure.
I love it.
Let's do it. Know more about your building.
Don't leave me out. Don't
property.
Leave me out.
Yes.
Yeah.
Love it. After this, we'll schedule it.
Sounds good.
Keeping is good.
I'm such a hugger. I missed that. And so a couple of the times recently I've seen people, you know, we both have masks on and I'm like, can I hug you, please? I just missed that in-person interaction. Back to the Zoom, Sukki, you guys did a great job with recently the mentoring program. It was neat to be able to, so tell us a little bit about the mentoring program. And then I just thought it was so neat to be able to meet everybody, you know, together all at once, which you felt like you were in the same room, you know, but via Zoom. And I just happened to be in Mexico at the time, so that was even better.
Yeah, so the mentoring program is through our Women in Business Council. It's a yearly program where we put together proteges with mentors like Kelly. So it's an application process. Everybody gets a DISC assessment. We match people up based on what they're looking for from a mentor or a protege. And this year is going to be fully virtual. Our first meeting, I think, which is what you're mentioning, our first mentoring program workshop was the last program of the speaker series. So Jen Burwell, the chair of the WIB, Women in Business, and I were both at BD because we were doing one of our cool live broadcasts, you know, and we don't want to just have a Zoom room. So we're doing it live from BD's headquarters, and they set up tables for us so that we could sit down and join all of you on Zoom and give you a behind the scenes look at what was going on. And then of course, piping through the speaker. But it is really nice because we have participants that, you know, aren't going back into their office right now. Some of the folks that work for larger corporate, they're not going back to their offices. Some folks have home offices. Some people are traveling, living, you know, somewhere else right now, and they can all join and then also meet between the workshops via Zoom or Duo or whatever they choose. So it does make the mentoring program a little bit different, but I think it'll still succeed. The content's the same. The relationship is just as good as it can be during a pandemic. And we also shortened the program. Instead of 6 months, we have it as 3 months, and we just are two workshops a month. So, you know, we really had to think about ways that we could make it easier to be a part of these types of programs.
Yeah. And I think that's true. The more we have used technology and use, you know, that can be in real estate and in any business you own, in the association, to make it easier for us to get together is better. Dillon, you talked about having, you know, people that can do from New York can look at the home inspection, then you send, I assume, all the reports digitally, you know, immediately for the realtors and everybody. Used to be when I was in real estate, feel like decades ago, you know, you had to wait 3 to 5 days, and then you had to, you know, wait to upload the pictures and all that. So I bet it's way faster and quicker time frame for the inspection period now, huh?
Yeah, absolutely. And even just, I'll also let Rochelle talk about this too, but those inspection periods are becoming shorter too, you know, and we're trying to be able to meet that need too. But absolutely, I mean, that is a big change I made this year, is I actually started a new software program. So for all of our inspectors, for writing reports, and also for scheduling, I noticed that what we were using wasn't getting the job done fast enough. And so I made some changes, and it was some growing pains, but after about a month, we were able to basically, in the same amount of time, in that 3 hour time period, we write the whole entire report, take every photo, and we're still taking between, you know, 100 to 200 photos. So we're still providing a very detailed report. But then able to send it out, you know, basically the second we walk away from the inspection, and that equals just efficiency all around, and then more time with our families. So that's always good.
That's right. More balanced life, right?
Absolutely. Yeah.
Isn't that the goal for all of us?
It is. Absolutely.
You talked about the scheduling. You have that on your website, which is, you know, people want ease of use, right? And they want something quick and easy. So I bet you've seen an increase in business. So for our entrepreneurship listeners out there, tell us a little bit about your scheduling app. And I know Rochelle uses one as well.
Yeah. Basically, it's all done online. I mean, you can still call the office, and we have a representative that will answer and take care of you guys. But it seems like more and more people want to see a website, see photos, see social media, and no matter what they're on, you know, whether it be LinkedIn or Facebook or whatever they're on, looking at our site, they can click schedule now, and it takes them to our scheduling platform, and they can choose the exact day and time and everything. And it'll go into our, basically, you know, our scheduling software. It's not going to put it in right away. It kind of allows us to make some changes, make sure we need, get all the information we need, and you know, if we need to call the seller and make sure they're okay with that, we'll do that and get access information and such. But as far as the consumer or the client, yeah, it makes it really easy. They, you know, sometimes it's like 11 o'clock at night and I get a text saying that somebody scheduled. I'm like, good, you know, whatever, you know, we're not going to answer the phone, but you can go on and schedule anytime you want. So it's kind of nice.
That is great. Rochelle, you use that a lot, don't you?
Yes, I love online scheduling. You know, people want to book a time to talk with me after business hours. It's totally cool. I answer my cell all the time. So call my business line. I mean, online scheduling is just easier because then people get to choose kind of what works for them instead of the old time where, you know, you do an email back and forth. Well, I can do Wednesday at 3, but by the time they get back to you, you know, it's like, oh, I'm sorry, I'm not available then anymore. Like, it's just really easy to secure your spot online. And there's so many great scheduling apps. So many of them are free. Some of them are like $5 a month. It doesn't even matter. If you're a business owner, there's no reason to not have someone be able to book an appointment from your website, from your Facebook, from your Instagram. It is just a click of a button. And I know, you know, Kelly does it too with her free consults. I mean, there's no reason, especially in this day and age, to not just give people the ability to just schedule without calling you.
Absolutely. And it increases business and it, yes, because it increases productivity. I'm sure, Sukki, with people being able to register for events, it's not like you have to, you know, call. They can, you can consistently have access to all of the events on the Tempe Chamber's website. And at my midnight working, oh yeah, I forgot I had to register for that. You know, it makes it really easy for those of us who have odd hours, right?
Yeah, it is. It is easy to register for the events. The other thing is too, is now we're recording all of our events. So if somebody registers and pays for a ticket, or if they missed a free event, you know, we're recording a majority of everything that we're doing, maybe not committee meetings, but so if somebody wasn't able to make it, we have that recording on demand. So now we're watching the numbers of visibility go up even higher. So we have so many people tuned into the live broadcast, and now we're watching the clicks and watches on the Vimeo links that we send them when they register.
That's so awesome.
Yeah. And we haven't had that before. So we haven't had on-demand content of our signature events. It was a lunch in a ballroom. And if you made it, great. If not, you missed out on some good chamber chicken and some great content. So, you know,
was that another invite or
buy tickets?
Anything that has to do with food, I'm in.
Yeah. Now I have to say, I really don't miss the food and beverage portion is something that is just one more layer of worry that you have every time you have an event. And I don't miss worrying about that. That's one. I mean, there's a lot of other things to worry about on the production side, the lighting, the microphone, speakers showing up through the virtual and not breaking out with their, you know, issues with their quality of video, but not having to worry about food has been a little bit nice. It's been very
different. Other silver lining. See, yeah. Who would have thought we wouldn't have to worry about food?
My favorite.
That was thing. Around every event, right? Before this. tell us, Sukki, while we have you on the topic of events, tell us, so for people who don't know, you know, the Tempe Chamber of Commerce, people think of, you know, chambers of commerce as probably they put you in a certain category, right? They think of you as just business advocacy or just events or just networking. And the Tempe Chamber has been a wealth of knowledge for me and networking opportunities. You know, I've used it for all of my businesses and love all of it. But for people who don't know, tell us, give us kind of an overview of the of why people would want to become a member, especially right now.
Yeah, so when we talk to potential new members or even existing members, you know, we want to know what their pain points are. We listen what's important to their company at this time moving forward, you know, and how can we help them? So we have programs that are very diverse that companies can get involved in if they wish to. Sometimes companies just join because they want to support our mission. They want to help, you know, support the advocacy that we do. Others have other reasons for joining. Maybe they have employee resource programs inside of their company that we can help add to. So we have a military affairs committee. We have a business and women in business council. We have a young professionals group. And every employee within a membership can be a part of the chamber. It's not just one person that's a part of the chamber, it's their entire staff. So, you know, maybe that's the reason. Maybe their concern is workforce pipeline, and we do a lot of workforce development programs. And through our foundation, we have an internship program, Career Ready Tempe. So we have something for everyone. If their focus is one way, we talk to them about how they can get engaged. Others are just looking for a way to say, I'm out here in the community supporting the community. So it might just be, you know, we want to sponsor events so that the community knows we're out here supporting women in business or supporting the military affairs. So we have something, we have reasons for everyone to join. So I think that the great thing about our chamber is we have so many diverse programs that there's something for everybody.
Including the Business Owners Forum, which is one of my favorites. And you talked about listening to the, you know, to the membership and what they were missing. And I remember, I don't know, 10 to 12 years ago or something, whenever, you know, that was, that came out of a membership, you know, questionnaire, what's missing, and having that round table of business owners, that's not, you know, it's not a networking group. It's a, all of us trying to figure out, you know, how to help each other. And so you guys just started it and, you know, we took it and ran with it. So I think it's, you know, again, like you said, it's, there's something for everybody. I was just on the phone with a guy yesterday, and he just moved here. And I said, that's okay. You live in Gilbert. You, I bet you have clients in Tempe. And because he's really big on like military, you know, he's a veteran. And I said, you have to get involved with the military affairs committee. I mean, there really is something for everybody. And even if it's just, I mean, I tell clients, you have to have three things you're a part of, right? Whether it's a nonprofit, association, or other organizations, be a part of three things. And I always include the chamber as one of my three things that they should be a part of, because of the amount of stuff that you guys have that can be for anybody. So whether you're in Peoria, you know, have valley-wide real estate, you know, anywhere, you can have the content, you can have the brand awareness, you can have, you know, just giving back. I mean, a lot of times it was, for me, it was like, I just want to give back to my community. You know, how do I do that? Okay, be a part of committees inside the chamber so that I can give back my time. I'm a huge advocate of the chamber.
Well, and I have to say, Dillon and Rochelle, you know, you can probably understand this now more than ever, you know, leaning on each other as a support system. You know, like the Business Owners Forum, that has become, it has grown and grown since the pandemic, because we're really leaning on each other for, you know, I'm having issues with my business. I'm not sure how to swerve during the pandemic. That goes for the mentoring program too. You know, it's great to have a relationship where you can lean on each other and have, you know, some support system, because a lot of people are just staying at home. They're not getting that contact point. And if we can help make those contacts either for business or personal, it makes me really proud to do what we do.
I just wrote a blog yesterday about outside perspective. You know, you need, every business owner needs an outside perspective, right? Have somebody else look at your business and help you. And may not be the people that you surround yourself with every day. Maybe it's the network, you know, maybe it's the Business Owners Forum. Oh my gosh, you know, you're running into something. So you guys have such a great platform. Speaking of business ownership, Rochelle, tell us something you would have liked to know 10 years ago as a business owner, and what you're gonna do now with that knowledge.
Yeah, 10 years ago, I wish I had read this book called The 12-Week Year. And The 12-Week Year is this organizational system of how to do goal planning and time management and project management. And I did a mastermind with my friend Kenyatta Turner a couple of years ago. I can't even believe it's been a couple of years ago. And ever since then, I have operated my business and my personal life on this like system. And the philosophy is everyone sets goals in January, but by like March or April, you may have forgotten what they were and you may not have even looked at them. And so by October, if you take a look, it's like, oh, I got to cram it all in before I make next year's goals. Well, the 12-week year is just the system for what can you get done in 12 weeks and get it done. So it helps you be way more productive, set goals, knock them out, and move on. So I've implemented it again this year. And I never really start on the first of the month or anything. My my 12-week year starts sporadically, but if I had known that, I would have been way more organized and given myself way more breaks, because I schedule in, you know, depending on, you know, the week, the 6th and the 10th week of the 12-week year, I'm always taking time off. Like, even though we're in a pandemic and I work from home, it's still important for self-care. So it's like a 4-day weekend, even when you're just lounging around the house, is a lot different than just working 7 days a week. Mm-hmm. So it's been extremely helpful.
We all need a reset, right? And the only way you can reset is by taking time away, right? And out of your business. And I love that idea of the 12-week year, because you're right. People, like, I do my goals in December, right? For the whole year. If I didn't have a coach to keep me accountable every 3 months, like, I know I have a call, you know, next month, I'm like, oh man, I better have all that stuff checked off, right? But if you don't have a system in place, if you don't have those people, even just a book, right, can get you on track and keep you accountable for 12 weeks. Okay, now I got to do my next 12 weeks, right? And shout out to Kenyatta. She runs a great mastermind for that, for, you know, for the 12-week year. I've heard all about it, and it sounds amazing. I can't wait to do hers, to do that mastermind with her at some point. Dillon, what about you? You started your business, you said, a little over 3 years ago. If you could go back 3 years, what did you wish you knew then, and how are you going to use it now?
Oh, so much. I really do. I mean, like I said, I was just a fireman, you know, and that's what I always wanted to be. And before I was a fireman, I was swinging hammers and digging ditches. So, you know, I had this idea and this dream of owning a business, but I didn't really realize how much planning needed to be done. So fast forward, I owned the business for about 6 months, and basically I'm doing 3 inspections a day, which I told you I don't do anymore, because it's not the, you're not providing the best service. You know, you really aren't. You're just physically exhausted by the time you get to that 3rd one. So that's not fair, right? But no, it's, you know, I just wish I would have had a plan. And there's, you know, for every business, there's a different plan that needs. I mean, a home inspection business could be completely different from something even very similar, a remodeling homes or something like that. So, or a real estate business, you know, and, so I, you know, it, just having a plan and sitting down with people who have done it before would have been huge. You know, I just got off the phone, a little bit earlier today with an inspector who's been doing it for 20 years. And I was just picking his brain about some things we're dealing with right now. And he was just like, I've been there, you know? And I was like, well, what do I do? You know? And he had all the answers. And I was just like, I should have made this phone call before I started my business. And then I could have planned for when things like this happen, you know? So that's just kind of a basic way to say it. Just have a plan, research and talk to people, and, you know, it'd be all right.
Yep. And continue to talk to people, right? And continue to reach out and have the help and surround yourself with the right people, right? To be able to get the help you need. And like you said, it could be 2 of the same exact businesses, 2 inspectors, 2 realtors, but everybody's goals are different. So your business cannot be the same as somebody else's. So it all that matters is what you want out of your business, right? And then you form the plan around that.
Right. Yeah, I think I need to read Rochelle's book she's talking about, because I haven't figured out the time off yet. So yeah, it's just the reality of it, but that's all right.
You'll figure it out. Usually up through 3 years, you're pretty good. And then after about the 4th year, you're going, okay, I can't sustain this anymore.
Right.
You'll figure that out pretty quickly. Yeah. Even if it's 48 hours, you know, like you do your 24 on and 48 off, you know, even if it's those 36 hours of no, you know, no communication, no internet,
right.
Even that will help reset for sure. I'm sure Rochelle can attest to that. And even Sukki, I know Sukki, you've been better lately, right? About taking some time off and a little reset.
I've been trying.
You have to. You guys have such so many events and so many balls in the air all the time. Tell us something for you that you wished you would have known 5 to 10 years ago that you're going to use now.
Ooh, 5 to 10 years ago that I wish I would have known. Well, 5 to 10 years ago, I wasn't in the nonprofit industry. So we are a 501c6, which is a nonprofit. And it was always my goal to work, so I always have served on boards and I've always been a volunteer in the community. And I was like, you know what, I'd really like to get paid to do what I do on the side. So I wish I would have done it sooner, moving over to the nonprofit side, because I really enjoy helping people. And that's what keeps me motivated, that keeps my engine running, and I'll do it 24/7 until I get it done. So that really does drive me. But yes, I am taking 10 days off in March, and I'm just going to do some self-care and downtime, because Lord knows I need it. Yeah.
Ooh, that's exciting. Where are you going somewhere?
Yeah, I'm going to do a little tour of California. I'm going to drive to Palm Springs, then to Temecula, and then to Coronado, where my girlfriend lives. So just a little drive tour.
Awesome. That's exciting. That's nice even to get out of your norm, right? So we did a lot of driving this last year because we couldn't, you know, get on an airplane. We love traveling the world, right? But we couldn't. So we're like, okay, well, let's just go see Arizona. And it was, what a cool thing. Like, you lived here. I've lived here my whole life. And to go see all the places I hadn't been, it's a nice reset for you. I'm excited. That'll be good for you.
Yeah.
I'm going to hold you accountable, right? I'm going to see how you did with your time off.
if you see me answering emails during that time period, you can smack me.
That's right. Don't answer her. That's great. So what else is there? Other shifts you've made over the last year that you are excited about, Rochelle, Dillon, or Sukki? You know, stuff that you thought was, you know, maybe really bad, but in the end it turned out to be really good, right? A lot of us have started out last year, I think, thinking, oh, this is going to be a nice 2-week break. No big deal. We'll come back. And then, you know, when you come to find out it's going to be a lot longer, some of us had, you know, trouble, and some just shifted really easily. And, you know, I think a lot of that has to do with mindset and how we think about things. So that for me, it was, you know, thinking the silver lining, right? What is that silver lining? That we're home and, you know, have the kids home and work from home and not get to see anybody. Because Josh is a fireman, you know, we knew he was going to get it. We knew we were overexposed, so we wanted to stay home and be real careful. Is there something you guys have used that you had in 2020, you know, that you're going to continue to use now?
Absolutely. I think, you know, with having to close down and figure out how to work remotely, was such a giant shift, and the pace of life changed. I used to just be in my car all the time, managing this appointment, that appointment, boom, 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 60, 80 hours a week, no problem. And now all of a sudden it's like, wow, I spent like 20 hours a week just in my car. you know, so it's just a different pace of life, you know, where I cook dinner every day now. And before it was, you know, I'd eat something as quick as I can at like 8 o'clock at night so I could have some time to spend with my hubby, you know, but I don't think I'm going back to that insane pace anymore because it was unnecessary. And I don't think I would have figured that out if I hadn't been forced to like stay at home and figure out how to work smarter and not harder.
Yeah, that's huge. The slower pace definitely made us all, a lot of us, you know, more present, right? Did it make you feel present and in the moment? I felt like, whereas before it was like, where am I going next? Where am I going next? You know, who I got to drop off? Who I got to pick up? Who, you know, and now it feels like you can be more present with the slower pace. So that's awesome. Dillon, what about you?
I think, like I mentioned earlier, you know, making that software change was huge because the one we used before was, you know, not the most user-friendly. And so we would snap photos, you know, like I said, 100 to 200 photos at the house and then come home. And you've been gone, you know, a little while, you've been gone half the day, you get home and then you're sitting there at a computer working on reports and trying to recall what you saw and what was said and everything. And, you know, I have an 11-year-old daughter, you know, and a wife and everything. And so they're getting home from school and their job, and want to be together. You want to discuss what the day held and all that. And then I'm working on my report. And then as a business owner, I'm kind of taking care of some of the other things that came up that day, or phone calls or emails or, you know. So that new report software was just amazing because I was able to do the report on site. Not only were we providing a better service to our agents who refer us, to our clients who have that 5-day inspection period, but then also, like I said, we were able to spend time with our families. And so, you know, I'm actually able to go to my daughter's volleyball practice now, which I, you know, I wasn't doing that before. And I'm like, man, how much did I miss, you know? And I love having, being able to make money to afford things like that, to afford, you know, a new pair of shoes for her or whatever else she needs, you know, a new net in the backyard. But if I can't be there and be a part of it and go out in the backyard and hit the ball around with her, why am I doing this? Why am I spinning my wheels? You know? So like you said, Rochelle, just being able to make dinner. And I mean, that stuff is so important. And as a firefighter too, we already are gone a third of our life, you know, and we don't really think about that. So then the other 2/3, I was pretty much gone those 2/3 as well. So, you know, not only am I home, but I'm less tired and I'm just, more patient, more willing to just be there with my family and desire to be there with my family and figured out how important it really is. So
yeah, the return on investment for technology and outsourcing stuff is, you can't put a number on that, because it's the sanity, right? It's the happiness, it's the balance. Like, those things don't have numbers, right? Yeah. If somebody figures that out, let me know. I'd like to be able to have ROIs on those. But makes your life so much better to have not have the stress of all of it as a business owner, because it's not necessary, you know, it's not necessary to do all of that yourself. Sukki, what about you? Anything you learned last year that you're continuing to do this year?
Well, it's not so much what I've learned, but my family members are now finally with it enough to, you know, use Zoom, because my parents didn't even have a webcam. They had a, you know, a desktop PC, but it didn't, I tried to set up a webcam 3 different times when I moved back to Ohio. They finally got a laptop, and now I see them every Sunday, and it really helps. And my son in Cleveland, you know, I see him often as well. So now that I've got everybody else up to speed on technology, it's really helped me from missing my friends and family back in Ohio. But I've been using those for a long time. You know, in corporate, we were doing go-to meetings and Zooms all the time. We had remote teams. So I was already used to that part for work, but it's nice to be able to use it and, you know, stay in touch with loved ones.
That's awesome. Yeah. Shifting gears a little bit. So real estate, that's a hot topic, you know, just like COVID and everything else. Real estate's a really hot topic right now because the market is so insane. Rochelle and Dillon, can you give us a little... Rochelle, some stats or how the Arizona market's doing and where you think it's headed?
Yeah. Well, the market is continuing to increase. You know, we still have a lot of demand and not a lot of supply. So that's a recipe for appreciation. So a lot of people saw their houses increase in value by quite a bit, like a few percentage points between December and January. So our inventory in the Phoenix metro area is extremely low. Like Maricopa County single family residences, you're looking at like 5,000 houses. I mean, we have almost 7 million people here, maybe 5 in the county. It's a lot. It's like we have a lot of people and not a lot of houses available. So that's not normal. We usually have 3 or 4 as times as many available on the market. So you know, we're seeing a lot of craziness on the buying side, you know, where people are spending $30,000-$40,000 bringing cash to closing above the selling price. So it's kind of hard to compete, obviously, as a buyer in that market if you don't know what's really going on in the background and if you don't have an experienced agent who can kind of win out above all of the competition. It's not unusual for a house these days to get 11 or 12 offers on it before one is accepted, and there are still cash buyers. So there's a lot of competition and a lot happening, but on the seller side, a lot of people are, you know, kind of reluctant to sell because they don't know where they're going to buy. And, you know, for those people, all I can say is Phoenix is a big place. And if you're working virtually, maybe you want to cash out some of that equity and move somewhere where you can get more house for less money and put some away for retirement. It's a great time to do that. Now is the time to do that. And interest rates are still super low. I mean, they're in the twos. I remember when I was in lending, I was excited to get someone in a six, you know, like that. I thought that was low back in 2010 and 11 and or seven and six. And now we're, you know, 2 point something. It's ridiculous. Money is so cheap and kind of free right now that even if you're buying a house in the 400s, it's still cheaper than renting. I mean, the market is just nuts. So for anyone looking to or worried about buying real estate or worried about selling real estate, there are always solutions to fit your needs. And it's Arizona. It's always going to be a good time to buy. There's been a lot of speculation about a crash coming. And it's fair to think that that may happen. But the reality is it should have already happened. It should have happened years ago. But the issue that we've got is interest rates are so low and demand is so high and people keep moving here. We have huge corporations moving their headquarters here, moving their, and I'm sure Sukki can speak to the growth of business in Arizona better than I can, but it is nuts. Chandler is going nuts. You know, like it is an insane market right now because Phoenix is a great place to be. We've got people coming from the East Coast and the West Coast where the cost of living here is so much cheaper and the weather is so great. 8 months out of the year. So.
Even from Texas, now everybody's going to move from Texas, right?
Yeah. Oh, I feel so bad. You know, my sister lives in East Texas and they didn't have power for like 4 days. Like, it's just so bad. And, you know, freak weather conditions aside, like, Arizona has great weather regardless.
That's right. And speaking of moving out a little bit, Dillon, you know, people, when people think of inspections, I bet you most of the time they think of resale homes, right? Older homes that they need an inspection on. But tell us, at least I know, as a client of mine, I know the whole deal, but tell people who don't know what other inspections there are besides just, you know, a resale inspection.
Yeah, so new builds, like we've said a couple times in this time we're here together, that Phoenix is expanding. You know, it's becoming a giant area. And so with that, you have new build communities all over. You see the American flag about every square mile, you'll see one sticking up. And so that's usually what that means. It's a model home. Go walk through it, check it out, right? Yeah, but there are some challenges with that from the inspection industry as far as we're concerned. Some of the things we're finding, you know, and I would never badmouth a specific builder out there. I mean, hey, it's all Arizona contractors doing everything they can to just keep up, you know, but the things we're finding are fairly significant. I mean, we're finding things like frayed wires, which could be a significant fire hazard. I mean, we're finding pretty bad roof issues. One time I was in an attic and I found that the heater, the furnace hadn't been hooked up to the gas yet. And this was a house that people had lived in for a year. And it was a pretty cold winter too. So it was like, well, hold on a second. You guys didn't have heat at all. So, you know, thankfully it's not as cold as Texas right now, but, you know, hey, these are just things that we're finding. And, you know, I've used my social media pretty well to kind of get the word out of these things and done a little advertising that way of, you know, hey, it's $350 is our average price. And it varies depending on the size, but that's a very small investment for a very large long-term investment. You know what I mean? And you know, these builders are very accommodating. They're very willing to fix the things we find and point out. They don't want to provide a bad product. You know, they want more people to buy from them. So, but yeah, I think it's just holding those builders accountable to, you know, a high level of expertise out there when they're building these homes. And, you know, the same time is that, again, with technology, you have younger people coming out of college or maybe not even going to college, but they're getting tech jobs and finding ways to get into that. So there's less people in the trades. So now basically anybody who can swing a hammer is who's building these homes. And, you know, I'm not saying that there's not experience out there, but there's room for us to find things and, you know, call things out and kind of keep the standards high in that new build area. So we do pre-drywall inspections, which is huge. I mean, having us come in and look at the plumbing, the electrical, the framing, the way things were built before they're covered up That's a huge deal. So that service has grown exponentially this last year. We can come in right before you guys move in. And again, it's like right before I sign my name off on this, I just want to double check, make sure everything's good to go. And then the other very popular inspection is what I call the 11-month warranty, because every builder is required to give that 1-year warranty, basically bumper to bumper. Anything that goes wrong in the house for first year, we'll cover it. And so we come in and we put blue tape all over the house on every little, you know, nook and cranny and, you know, scuff on the wall, but we find some fairly significant things too. So it's pretty good. And we've done pretty well with it. So
I can't stress the importance of getting an inspection in real estate. A lot of people will be tempted to waive. It's like, what are you doing? Like, this is the biggest transaction, financial transaction, probably of your life. And you only do it so many times. And having a thorough inspection done by someone like Dillon's company is critical. It is a no-brainer. It is such a tiny, tiny part of the cost of buying a house. Like, just spend the money. It is so worth it to just know what the problem is in advance, so you're not in a money pit and you can't do anything about it. Sure. Especially in Arizona. Like, we have crazy problems sometimes with houses, from old plumbing to old electrical. And this is just stuff, just hire a professional. You don't have to be the pro. Hire a pro like Dillon. Get it done. No big deal.
Absolutely.
That's exactly right. Well, can you believe it's almost been an hour since we've been chatting? Sukki, any last minute items that we didn't cover that you would like people to know about the chamber?
Well, I really just want to reinforce that, you know, our membership is what drives us. And I am so grateful for our members, especially the volunteers who come to committee meetings and really help us formulate and put on our programs. We recently asked the ambassadors and committee volunteers if they would help us get the city's PPE supplies out to local businesses. And today I just ran the report for the city, and our ambassadors and our volunteers of our members delivered 340 PPE supply kits to businesses. So, you know, our volunteers help us make an impact, and I'm just so grateful for our members and the relationships that I've built with all of you. And you guys are what keep us running and keep me moving and motivated.
Oh, that's so nice. It gives me chills hearing that. It's such a great, you know, it's a testament to your organization that we all want to help, right? We want to see you succeed. And so that's why we keep helping and keep volunteering, you know, for associations and organizations like yours. Thank you so much for being on today. Dillon, what about you? Did I miss anything for your Protect Property inspections?
No, I'm just happy to be here. Thanks for having me. Like Rochelle said, I think she said it best, it's just not worth it to skip out on home inspection, you know, and especially coming from out of state or something like that. Again, people are trying to put together the best offer, and they'll say, well, we'll just say we're not going to do an inspection. And that way they take our offer, you know, and it's like, it's just not worth it. You know, if you can't find out exactly what's going on with that home before you buy it, don't buy it. You know, we see so many nice remodels, and then when you really dig into them or get up in the attic, it's bad news. So don't take any chances out there. Hire a professional, like she said.
Yeah, exactly. She said it. She's a good advocate for you.
Yeah.
Thanks for being on, Dillon. And Rochelle, anything I missed in real estate?
I think we covered it all. It's a hot market. It's always a good time to buy and sell. And call me if you've got questions.
So tell us now, everybody, tell us how we can get a hold of you. Rochelle, you start.
Yeah, my name is Rochelle Poulton. You can find me online at azownit.com, or you can call me at 480-400-1297.
Thank you so much. Dillon, what about you? How can people find you?
Dillon Winiecki here, the owner of Protect Property Inspections here in Arizona. Protectpropertyinspections.com, 480-808-2828. And please check out our new and improved social media.
Yay. I know that was a fun project to do together. Sukki, what about you?
Sukki Jahnke, VP of the Tempe Chamber. Just visit us at tempechamber.org. We've got a staff page where you can reach us directly at our desk. All of our programming and mixers and information about our committees is online. And just reach out if you have any questions or if you're already a member and you want to just chat it up and see how we can help. We're here.
Thank you so much, all of you, for being on today. It was my pleasure to have you on Collaborative Connections Radio Show and Podcast, sponsored by KLM Consulting. Get more time to do the things you love and build a thriving business with the help of KLM Consulting. Tune in on the third Thursday of every month at 1 p.m. Until next time, happy connecting.